All right, folks, welcome back. This is the weekend commentary for the ICT Mentorship. All right, so we have the dollar index and non-farm payroll Thursday and Friday conditions sent us lower into the volume imbalance. Now, before I start speaking on this, it's important that you go back and watch the midweek review, okay, so that we have things in proper context. Because at first listen, it's going to sound like I'm saying I told you so, when that's not what I'm saying. Okay, at the time I was doing the recording on Wednesday, the market hadn't given me the information that I need, and I'll go over that information in this video. So that's kind of like the teaching portion of this weekend. But I'm going to try not to spend too much time on this video, because if I do, it just seems like I'm trying to create filler. And I have lessons next week, but this one is really central to why I don't participate in non-farm payroll, why it's important for you to observe that level of risk that I hold towards it, and to prevent anything that would cause harm financially or set you back in your development. So I mentioned there was this opening here on this fair value gap that might need to close in. And if it did that and it went above here, my attention was here, and that's why I'm teaching you that if this does in fact get traded through, your focus goes here for non-farm payroll. If it fails to go higher, watch this fair value gap in here. And basically you want to be looking at the 90-90 level to 90-75 level, what is the high of this candle and then the low of this candle. I mentioned that would be a level to watch. And also, should we get through this, the volume imbalance is where it's going to go to. It traded through the consequent encroachment, midpoint of the volume imbalance. So we're looking for continuation lower. If it gets through here, sell side liquidity below here. Okay. My long-term bias has been bearish on the dollar because I've been bullish on commodities. You know this because I've been calling the grain markets and the meat markets higher. I said that those markets would be bullish going into 2021 and probably rolling right on into 2022. That is a mirror image of what we'd expect to see in the dollar index, because as commodity prices go higher, dollar goes lower. The buying power of the dollar is reduced based on inflation. So we did get the delivery here. And these are a little bit unnerving for me as a mentor, because as much as I tell you that there probably isn't going to be a move that's favorable because of non-farm payroll, the idea of missing a move when you see a really nice run like that, it makes you second guess my advice when it comes to trading around non-farm payroll. Because some of you could clearly see this in hindsight and say, wow, that was a really easy sell now that you see it in the chart. It's altogether something different when you get in the marketplace and then you're positioned ahead of non-farm. And we had, and I mentioned this on my community tab this morning for my Saturday post that I usually try to put up on it. I mentioned that the projected numbers for non-farm payroll, they expected to see an addition of a lot more jobs being added than what we got. And I find it interesting, and you should be finding it interesting as well, that failure to meet that number happens to justify this run down into this level that we were looking for as a downside draw. The context of what I said on Wednesday, okay, if you listen to it and you're not really paying attention, it sounds like I'm giving you a multiple choice A, B, or C. And that is a myopic way of looking at it, because I've given you in Wednesday's video parameters that would lead to it if it goes here or if it goes here. Now, with this run down outside of this fair value gap that you've known about, I mentioned also in the video that this would be favorable because it would be in line with my higher time frame bias on the dollar. The draw into this discount array, while it's not in my opinion, high probability because of non-farm payroll. If it were any other day, we would be in these types of runs, but it doesn't happen a lot. And as I mentioned on my community tab this morning, it's been a rather moot event for non-farm payroll because since 2016, the jobs numbers have been improving, but they haven't really caused a lot of excitement in the marketplace. Now, because of the new administration and the eventual effects of shutting our country down for as long as it was, all those chickens are coming home to roost now, okay? And what I mean by that, basically, like I mentioned in March and April of last year and all throughout the summer, that we wouldn't really see the impacts until 12 to 18 months. And now we're starting to see that. And we've been seeing the buildup in prices for commodities, grains, and meats. Look at lean hogs. I mean, it's entered the stratosphere, okay? Bacon's ridiculously overpriced. Pork is really expensive. That's going to likely continue. And as long as that does, that's going to put pressure on the dollar index. And while I don't have it here, you can pull it up on your daily chart. That low is also in contention once we get below this low, if we get below it. But I believe it looks like we might get it. I mentioned on Wednesday that there was a likely trend line phantom forming, and we have that here. Okay, you can see we broke through it, and you always attack the midpoint right here where that sell side liquidity is. It went right there and then consolidated and then ran for the premium high level of the volume and bounce on the daily chart. That's what this level is here. Okay, this is the fair value gap that it traded up into and left that small portion on, but it broke down out of it. Now, on non-farm payroll Friday, as I mentioned on the daily chart portion of the commentary on Wednesday, I said that if we trade down through the fair value gap that was in this vicinity here, let me go back up to the daily chart here. I mentioned this area right here, which is essentially the 90-90 level to 90-75 or thereabouts. That's in here, okay? 90-75 and 90-90, okay? We traded down through it, and I said if we traded down through it and came back up in, that could act as resistance, which sends us up for a run into that volume and bounce. Go back and listen to Wednesday's video. You probably already downloaded it. It's in there. You can hear me say it. Those are conditions that, in my mind, sets up the low resistance liquidity runs. But try not to get so bent out of shape because you missed the move, remembering that it's not from payroll. And look how the number came out so awfully off target. Like, they were expecting a whole lot more jobs and it failed to do so. And look at the reaction in the marketplace. There are times when you'll get numbers that are coming out that are better than expected, and you'll still see a move like this. That's why I don't know what they're going to do, because there's manual intervention most of the time. When you see big events around non-farm payroll, that's manually done. So to answer a lot of questions that I get and have gotten from Friday is, why do I avoid taking these types of trades, because I could get moves like this? Well, most of the time you don't get moves like this. I know what the price should likely do, but every time I've traded it, if I looked at every non-farm payroll trade I've ever taken in my history as a trader, it's less likely that I'm going to be profitable than profitable. And my wins don't pay for the many losses that I get if I'm wrong. When I'm wrong, it's because everything I'm trading should be as it should be. You know, if the economic report comes out and it's in favor, which I'm not looking at, but I'm waiting for the reaction in price. This whole idea of knowing what the number is going to be and also what the market's going to do as a result of that number hitting the marketplace, that's a facade. And I bought into a lot of courses, services when I was younger, that claim to be able to do that stuff. And it's nonsense. It's absolute nonsense. And anyone that says they can do that, you know, they're a liar. This particular event each month has the highest level of manual intervention than any other event. Even FOMC rain announcements are better. And I'm not suggesting you should trade those either, but that is a better trade from an odds perspective than non-farm payroll, because this one's the circus ride. Like this one, you have no idea what they're going to do. And many times they go back and forth and they bust both sides of the marketplace. And then many times go right back to the middle of that range that they create at the release of the number. Whereas you have the market trading below that fair value gap that I mentioned on the daily, and then right back up into it here. Now what's actually occurring is we're seeing that displacement here creates a fair value gap and bearish order block. Trades up into it here, your stop would have to be above this level here. Would you have been stopped out? Probably. Your broker would probably open up the spread a little bit more to get your in-house liquidity, and then that's it, you're gone. So think about all the things that I just outlined here, all the things that are against you in terms of odds. Don't look at these moves here, even though it goes to where we were saying for the downside objective and reacting in levels where I mentioned that it should probably create a run from. Don't listen to these ideas I'm suggesting when I'm ahead of non-farm payroll, because this is one of the trepidations I feel when I comment ahead of non-farm payroll. I don't want any of you getting hurt. And if you were taking this trade and you were making money, it's going to trick you into thinking that it's going to be like this all the time. And then when the bad one comes, it hurts really bad because the spreads open up really wide. And sometimes your stop loss doesn't do what you want it to do. And it'll take you through a pain threshold that you don't want to see happen in your trading or in that particular event. And that's happened a lot to me. So while it does have a lot of the things we were looking for all of the sell side delivery down into here, what prevented you from expecting it to go up to that higher fair value gap on the daily chart? And again, let me go back to the daily chart. What prevented it going here? Well, the fact that we didn't get above Wednesday's high. We didn't even go through it at all. So on Thursday's trading, we just failed to make any new real high going into midnight. Rolls over. Smaller imbalance with bearish order block hits that here. So you have your optimal trade entry here, right on here, and then rolls down, comes back up in. Fair value gap inside the context of that daily fair value gap. Again, listen to Wednesday's video. Then the market has a sharp displacement on non-farm payroll numbers release. Immediately runs down, takes the sell side liquidity here, consolidates, runs back up into the sell side imbalance, buy side inefficiency, rejects, comes back down in, digs into consequent encroachment, midpoint of that volume imbalance on the daily chart, and remained heavy into the balance of the day. On the 15-minute time frame, you can see we had that run on the buy side liquidity here, shared on the daily log entry. Consolidation, small little run above the relative equal highs here. Breaks lower, institutional order flow entry drill, fair value gap, the whole business in here. All of this here, this is the same thing that occurred here. This is the same thing as this. It's the same fractal. It's going up to go down. It's going up to go down. It's going up to go down. And it's going up to go down. Okay, so you're creating that short-term premium in the marketplace and then expecting it to drive lower. And to some random level down below us? No. Inside of the level I outlined on the volume imbalance. So the main point in this lecture part is for you not to be discouraged because it did deliver on the bear side that we looked at. But it could have very easily been a lackluster number that came out that was probably in line with what the expectation was. And the market just consolidated like it has been doing for months. we don't get a whole lot of reaction, or haven't been getting a lot of reaction in non-farm payroll. It used to be like this. It used to be really nice and had a lot of volatility, which is what drew me to trading it. But we don't have that now. But yesterday was obviously a deviation from the norm over the last few months up to, you know, a couple years. All right, here's the euro dollar daily chart. And we have this down closed candle here, bullish order block. I wasn't able to find any more continuation to get down into here. So Thursday, in a mirror image of what we saw in the dollar index, market rallies back up, completely closes in the fair value gap here, which is what I was looking for if we were going to go on the upside. And now, because we've done that, it'll be interesting to see if we hold all that range here. Because if it's bullish and dollar is bearish, and long-term I believe it is, then it should start digging into this wick here. So we have consequent encroachment, midpoint of that wick. So in other words, the closing price to the high, get that 50 level, mark that on your charts and draw that out. That's your next objective. And we'll just look at around 122 big figure. And then it's 10 pip increments above that as we eat into this range and maybe even run through it. Do we need to come back down in to any of this here? Well, it can come back down into consequent encroachment of this fair value gap, which would also be right about this level here for the bodies of these candles. So we could trade down to that and then maybe reaccumulate and send it higher. Because it's Sunday, I don't know how it's going to open. Like, it could do something entirely different. But it really rammed it up above this old high, and we don't want to see it give much up in terms of retracing into this high. Like, in other words, we don't want to see it come all the way back down in to this for a bullish order block retest and go higher. That would not make any sense to me, because we've now taken external range liquidity out here. What's external range liquidity? From this high to this low, where's the buy side? Above this high. So it's traded through that. Now we created a new range from this low to this high. It's above here. So it does not need to come back down in to gather up any more accumulation of longs, because it's done so here, and it spent multiple days in here, almost a full week, and then displacement came later. So I don't think it needs to come back down. If it comes back down to this level here, that's probably not bullish at all. It's okay, and it's permissible for a price to come back down into midpoint of this fair value gap, reaccumulate in that level, and then, you know, try to send it higher after that. But it would be better if it just kept on going. I'd rather see that than any kind of retracement where we're at. Dollar index on the hourly chart. Short-term buy side liquidity pull here. And then that fair value gap is the premium high. Discount low. We traded through that from optimal trade entry on a bullish order block, fair value gap, and non-farm payroll. It's also, go over to the left. Here is your last up-close candle with a low and a lower low. And you have your breaker here. Okay, so draw that out in time. Yes, we traded up into it here, consolidated, left it, came back down into it there. Optimal trade entry. If it were not a non-farm payroll event, I would have been all over this as a long right there. And then would have basically got out here. I would have not held on to anything above here. I would have been getting out at that level or just below it, taking partials at this level, something at consequent encroachment, but everything would be off here. That's how I would have traded it. And you probably think, well, what's the benefit of that? Well, I'm telling you how I would have traded it if it were not non-farm payroll, using these as your premium targets. Euro dollar on a 15-minute time frame, you can see, again, that bullish order block here, fair value gap, trades down to optimal trade entry, New York open kill zone, order block, rallies. Really nice. Look at where the bodies stop. Yes, it wicks through and it eventually does trade higher, but it goes right to consequent encroachment, midpoint of this premium high and this discount low of that daily premium fair value gap on the euro. It trades there, comes back down, accumulates down by the discount low, rallies. What's in here? What's in here that it does just this return? Some of the folks that ask a lot of questions about, why doesn't the imbalance completely close in? I taught that last week as a lesson, and you're seeing it again, where this higher time frame fair value gap is the parent of this price swing. In other words, it's going to be subordinate to this level and not that of the lower time frame 15 minute or hourly imbalance that's down here. You're looking at this as it has to fill. And this is how people think that liquidity voids, okay, or buy side imbalance, sell side inefficiencies, or imbalances in general, or price vacuums, or whatever you want to call it. The idea is it doesn't need to come back down into this level. It's not necessary because we entered and changed the state of delivery because we moved from a lower time frame into a higher time frame premium array. This is the initial one, and this is connected to this one in the sense that this is the discount low and this is the premium high of the fair value gap on the daily chart. So once price trades into this fair value gap, all of this down here below this level is not of any concern near term anymore because the delivery has been changed from discount to premium, but now premium PD array, it has to be marked out as a individual equilibrium premium or discount. And this is the low end of it. So in other words, we went from a oversold condition to overbought to now, because we're inside of this range high and this range low relative to its daily fair value gap. You're going to need to listen to this part of the video a couple of times. We have entered, even though we're in a premium level, we're still now, when it trades back down in, we are at a short-term discount relative to this low on the fair value gap on the daily chart and this premium high of the fair value gap on the daily chart. So cancel all of this and just keep your focus on this level and this high. So when it trades back down in, this is short-term oversold. But when you compare it to something like this low or this low or this low or this low, and indicators would not see this as oversold. But I don't use indicators. I'm framing the context on what the market is going to seek and how the algorithm is going to refer to old data. Where are the concerns for us as a trader that wants to mimic what the algorithm is going to do? You have to watch how we move from one state of delivery, which is short-term oversold, overbought. Then once we cross this line here, we enter a new level where this is the framework. This is your dealing range. It's an implied dealing range, because it's not like this high and this low, okay? This is an imbalance area. So it's not the same, but you have to treat it just the same as if it were a level where it traded down as support and this found resistance. If I wanna use retail logic for a moment to help you understand it, we move into this area here. Once it trades back down in, that is short-term oversold or cheap or a discount, and it doesn't need to come all the way back down in to rebalance any of that, because we're looking at the higher time frame imbalance now being a greater factor, or as I mentioned, it's apparent compared to this child, which would be subordinate to the parent's authority over price, and the market eventually trades higher. British pound versus US dollar daily chart. And this one here, just like I said, I didn't know what it was going to do. I wasn't sure, and I've been really reluctant to even talk much about it, but I'm sticking with it to show you the levels and degrees of risk that are associated with it when it's not as clear. Imbalance in here, it's still likely to be the upside draw. I mentioned that these lows, which was sell side liquidity, and these highs are buy side liquidity. Which one it was going to go for, I didn't know, and it still didn't even run for it. Even though it went the direction towards this, it hasn't even traded up in here. I'm looking at it where that might be where it tries to draw to, but do I want to trade it? No. And you can see we've failed to get up there so far, and all of this in here is just really, really hard to read on the hourly chart. On the 15 minute time frame, again, real sloppy. We did get this on Wednesday. I mentioned how we could possibly see it run up here and then break down and run out its relative equal lows, which would have been these lows in here, as I mentioned, that Euro had essentially done that, but cable hadn't done it yet. Well, we went up into that level, filled in the complete closure of that fair value gap I was mentioning at the time on Wednesday. And then it traded lower, but then failed to go lower than this, consolidated, and then within this high and this low, just real sloppy price action. London created a short-term sell-off, took out some sell-side liquidity here, and then vaulted from there, going after the relative equal highs for buy-side liquidity. Swept this high here, came back down in. Now you have the low, high, low. If it were not non-farm payroll, this is your buy on a breaker. See this fair value gap back here? Extend that in your own chart. The same thing I just outlined on the euro is what's being seen here. That's why you don't have to have all of this level in here being rebalanced. Why does price only go down this far, Michael, and then go higher? Why doesn't it close in that? Well, it's because it's going back to this level here. And now we're at a higher premium level. While it's oversold here, it becomes overbought. Now we come back down into this level here. It's what? Oversold. It's cheap. It's a discount. And match that up with a bullish array. Low, high, lower low, bullish breaker. Extend that out in time. Here you go. Mean threshold essentially almost gets to it, but nonetheless, it's accumulating inside of this old fair value gap. This logic doesn't even get mentioned anywhere else, okay? When we see imbalances, we don't forget them, okay? They're going to exist as long as 60 days from now, okay, or behind us. Go back 60 days. Any fair value gap or any imbalances, the algorithm will use that level again. It might act as an inversion level. It might act as a support level. It might act as a target. It remembers it, okay? So if it remembers it and recalls it and trades against it, then we should be concerning ourselves with it as well. After 60 days, that tends to expire for me. The market eventually rallies up, peters out a little bit going into the close, and still leaves this level open. So we'll see if it wants to come back down and anything deeper. I'd like to run on the sell side liquidity here, a small little fair value gap. That would be a nice run that would set up here, something to practice in paper trade, or not really paper trade, but forward test and see if it does that very thing. And that'd be a nice little run, not a whole lot of pips, but something to obviously practice with. I like the fact that we took sell side liquidity here, and next level of sell side liquidity that would be taken here with a fair value gap, that would make sense, and then send us up into that daily fair value gap on GBP. And that, my friends, is going to be it. And try not to spend too much time jawboning. In short, I'm looking for continuation higher on cable. I'm looking for continuation higher on euro. I'm looking for continuation lower on the dollar index. And until I talk to you by way of the daily log entry on Monday, be safe. And to the ladies, if you're in attendance, happy Mother's Day.